Ratti buburi gizzari lavo pawarlo ride. Mure wuri gizzi bere gizzi da. Minnie's a hep cat now. She's as sharp as the cats allow. Say she's really up to date when she's togged out in her drape. Minnie's a hep cat now.
Although Cab and Yubi were enjoying the national spotlight during their tours, the travel was not easy, and not every gig would welcome them due to segregation and civil injustice. While these African-American men had it hard, things were even more challenging for Blanche Calloway and women at that time. It wasn't until the 1920s that women even had the right to vote in the U.S. For African-American women musicians, life on the road was extremely challenging. One woman, born in 1915, would grow up in Baltimore with a difficult life. This would give her a foundation of memories that she would soon share with the world.
Here's a woman that was experiencing the bitter from a young child on, and yet she managed to overcome it to the best of her ability at the time and create a body of work that will never be matched during our lifetime. If you heard Billie back in the day, you felt the pain or the joy or the melancholy, because it came out loud and clear. I think about the very important song, Strange Fruit. During the time that she's alive, lynching is de rigueur. Lynching is trendy. You know, if Facebook and Twitter and other social media were popular back then, you would say that lynching is now trending, because not too many people could get away from not knowing someone that had been lynched.
Billie was soon known as one of the greatest American singers of all time. She would use her national spotlight to challenge Americans.
Black bodies swinging in the southern breeze. Strange fruit hanging from the poplar trees.
Lewis Allen, and his real name, Abel Maripol. A lot of people associate her as being the writer of the song, but he was the true writer, and he was a Jewish school teacher. And the song started off as a poem that he set to music later on in the early 30s. So to hear this type of content was just incredible.
Billie Holiday speaks to the downtrodden person. She speaks to the heartbroken person. Her music speaks to anyone that is truly going through some struggle in life.
Not only were Billie Holiday's lyrics unique and radical, but she was also changing the way that vocalists sang with the bands. By changing the timing of her lyrics so she could sound more like Louis Armstrong, leading with his trumpet, she created a new vocal style that would influence almost every singer in the U.S. after her.
Billie Holiday once said that if the church had played the music of Louis Armstrong, she'd have been in the church. She went where Louis' music was, and that was into the bars, the clubs, the speakeasies, the brothels.
Them that's got. Ladies across the country, and even back in Baltimore, often tried to copy her. Billie took her voice and her image, and she rose above America's problems. That wasn't to say that she didn't have her own problems. Throughout her career, Billie battled with drug abuse and addiction. The content that Billie sang about was not just about the nation's problems, but it was also about her own personal problems, too.
But God bless the child
you know, her iconic song God bless the child who has his own, resonates with me on a daily basis, because no matter what life throws at you, you can go back and say that you're thankful because you got your own. And Billie struggled to get her own in so many ways. She had to perform in music halls where she couldn't go to the bathroom. And at some point, it's documented where she would go to the bathroom right on stage in front of the people. Billie also, in her music, you could feel the essence of the struggle. You can feel the essence of the pain. She was a true musician.
It was a time in America where the whole country could see African Americans through the lens of a brave few musicians and activists. Billie represented the struggle of the African American, and she also represented the struggle of the woman. Through her voice, she was inspiring women and African Americans to speak out and create their own. She was inspiring true change.
Rich relations give crust of bread and such. You can help yourself, but don't take too much. Mama may have, Papa may have, but God bless the child that's got his own, that's got his own.
God bless the child that's got his own.
While people like Cab, Yubi, Billie, and Blanche are playing all around the country, Baltimore's music scene is growing rapidly too. In 1939, while attending his last year at Douglas High School, a youngster piano prodigy in Baltimore, Ellis Larkins, became the first African American to be admitted into Peabody. In his early years, he was under the tutelage of W. Llewellyn Wilson, as well as a handful of Peabody teachers that would teach him off campus to avoid Peabody segregation rules. Most of the time, you could find him listening or playing around Pennsylvania Avenue. During Jim Crow, Pennsylvania Avenue was the hub for the best jazz music in Baltimore.
You know, it was a whole strip from one part of the bottom of Pennsylvania Avenue and Green Street all the way up to Reisterstown Road. That's a whole strip of nightclubs. So you could club hop from one club to the next. And believe me, if you had a band, you had a crowd. So you'd go Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. And sometimes during the week, you'd go down on Pennsylvania Avenue.
Thelma, the Avenue Cafe, the Comedy Club. These places are really important to us today because they give you some visual documentation. Many of them had what you would know as souvenir photographs, where you could have, there would be a photographer in there that would take a picture of you sitting at the table with your date, your wife, your jump off, your mistress, or whomever you're with, partying up, and you could buy a picture that now, decades later, helps us to interpret what the interior was like, maybe who was playing there, and what's going on, who's the proprietor. So those clubs up and down the Avenue, the Avenue Cafe, the Comedy Club, Thelma, are really important in our effort to document what the Avenue was truly like. Because if some big entertainers were at the Royal, but at some other point when they're socializing, they would go in and out to these other clubs. So it would be no big deal to see somebody coming in, having a smoke, having a drink at one of these places.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, we like to do a little novel number, a tune in time. Hey now. When I say hey now, I want everybody to shout hey now. Come on. Hey now! Good. Hey!
You know, the stories that my grandmother told me, you know, of the elegance of people, the way that they dress, the neighborhoods, and the art scene, and the class, and the dignity that was there.
Bad and bold, deep down in my pockets, I didn't have no gold. I looked up to the sky, to my surprise, I saw a $1 million bill floating before my eyes. I said, hey,
We're talking about Marble Hill, Druid Hill Avenue, McCullough. We're talking about Lafayette Square, where there's a church on every corner. We're talking about Sandtown, Winchester. This area comprises roughly 175 blocks of proverbial who's who in America, the largest district of African American history in the country. It was a sustainable community from birth to death. During Jim Crow, there was no need to leave your community. You had a nursery school, you had schools, you had churches, you had lawyers, doctors, you had music, piano tuners, you had nightclubs on the avenue, you had boarding houses and people's private houses, you even had a hotel on Pennsylvania Avenue. You had everything that a black person could need during Jim Crow. I would like to go back and interact with the everyday person and just vibe with them and think about their daily activity, how they would work hard, and then they would come home and they could leave their doors unlocked. And they actually knew the likes of a personal Cab Calloway, or they knew William Henry Chick Webb. They knew Milton Herbert Frisbee. They knew Tiny Bradshaw. They knew Blanche Calloway. They knew all these people because these were regular folk. These were everyday people that worked, but that were talented musicians, and that they would interact with you. They would come to the colored school to give her a program.
Through the lens of popular culture and music, in appearance, the 1940s ended in a positive light for the African-American communities in the U.S. The popular music celebrities gave the urban black communities a sense of pride and respect that was well needed and long overdue. But still, many challenges existed due to racism, growing poverty, and the troubled past of America.
They weren't making a lot of money. It was a tough life when they would drive from city to city in a big station wagon, okay, or in some type of bus.
In the 1940s, the segregated areas around the U.S. were exploding with culture and commerce. While things seemed positive around Pennsylvania Avenue, there was still a lot of work to be done toward equality. Poverty was too common in many segregated neighborhoods around the city. The poverty was so bad in some areas, it called upon governments and civil organizations to attempt to take on these challenges. In the late 1940s in Baltimore, a plan was put into place through the creation of a Mayor's Advisory Council on Housing Law Enforcement in an attempt to reduce poverty in the African-American neighborhoods. It was called the Baltimore Plan. In the end, after 2 years of enforcement, it was largely deemed a failure. The Baltimore Plan only rehabilitated 100 blocks of the 2,000 block initiative. At this rate, it would take 300 years to clean up Baltimore. Still, despite these challenges, things were looking up. Iconic musicians at the time, like Billie Holiday, were symbols of these changes. She stood up and sang for the African-American community's rights during every performance. And now, in the 1950s, even more people were standing up for rights across America. Demonstrators and protesters were seen in all the major U.S. cities, and they were definitely seen in Baltimore.
During Jim Crow, yes, it's a difficult time. Yes, we have the Depression. Yes, we have the migration where people are migrating from the South coming up to places like Baltimore, D.C., Philadelphia, and Detroit and Chicago for better lifestyle and job opportunity. Yes, you have an issue of lynching, but yes, you also have a level of cohesiveness that we may not ever see again in this lifetime. And that cohesiveness was not by choice, but by designed by racism, by this thing called segregation.
On May 17th, 1954, the racial landscape in America would be forever changed. Brown versus Board is over, and segregation in America is elected unconstitutional by the Supreme Court. Billie Holiday and the other early musical activists had succeeded in changing the perception of African Americans in modern America forever.
You have racism in everything, but you have those innovators who decide to break through those barriers by
knocking the racism down. I believe it was Benny Goodman that hired Teddy Wilson and Lionel Hampton to play at Carnegie Hall, which was one of the first few interracial groups. You had Billie Holiday performing with the Artie Shaw Big Band traveling through the South, which was a very harrowing experience.
When he starts in to love me, he is so fine and low.
Billie Holiday didn't live to see all the changes that she had inspired across the country. After her death, the country was about to face its issues head on, and it would be forever in a different place.